when Forrest Gump died, you don't know who Forrest Gump is? When Forrest Gump died, he stood in front of St. Peter at the pearly gates. St. Peter said, "Welcome, Forrest. We've heard a lot about you." He continued, "Unfortunately, it's getting pretty crowded up here. And we find that we now have to give people an entrance examination before we let them in." "Okay," said Forrest. "I hope it's not too hard." "I've already been through a test. My mama used to say, life is like a final exam. It's hard." "Yes, Forrest, I know, but this test is only three questions. Here they are. Which 2 days of the week begin with T? How many seconds are in a year? What is God's first name?" "Well, sir," said Forrest, "the first one is easy. Which 2 days of the week begin with the letter T? Today and tomorrow." St. Peter looked surprised and said, "Well, that wasn't the answer that I was looking for, but give a point, I give you credit for that answer." "The next question," said Forrest, "how many seconds are in a year?" 12. 12, said St. Peter, surprised and confused. "Yes, sir. January 2nd, February 2nd, March 2nd, and so on." St. Peter interrupted him. "I see what you mean. I'll have to give you credit for that one, too." "And the last question," said Forrest, "what is God's first name?" "It's Andy." "Andy," said St. Peter in shock. "How'd you come up with Andy?" "I learned it in church. We used to sing about it, and Forrest broke into a song. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he does with me." St. Peter opened the gate to heaven and said, "Run, Forrest, run." Thank you, Miss Dunn. 1 Samuel chapter 11, not as funny. 1 Samuel chapter. We're actually, Mr. Irby, we're going to get to 11 and 12 tonight. In even shorter time than 9 to 10. Rejecting the Lord. They were rejecting God as their king, and they wanted a human king. And Saul was the man that they picked to be that king. We looked at that last week. He was good looking, tall, handsome. What did you say it was here? Fine. In Blesian terms, he was fine. How do you say it? Fine. He was good looking. And when we left off, you know, we saw that Saul was being very humble. Even, you know, he was kind of hiding out when they wanted to make him king. You know, he was hiding out. He wasn't, you know, a real proud man. And so, and the people, some of the people refused him to be king, and he went back home. He's back working on the farm. And that brings us to 1 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1. Now, Nahash, the Ammonite, came up and besieged Jabesh-Gilead, and all the men of Jabesh said to Nashah, that Nahash, "Make a covenant with us, and we will serve you." This guy, this Nahash, this Ammonite, came up, and he camped against, as some verses say, camped against Jabesh-Gilead. He besieged it. He was there to annihilate and to take care of them, to wipe them out. And they say, "Let's make a deal. Let's work this out." Because they really didn't want to fight because they knew they were going to get killed if they fought. So, Nahash, let's make a deal. You know, Nahash's name, his name means serpent. He really is a snake. He's a beast of a guy. He's not a nice man at all, for sure. So, in verse 2, "But Nahash the Ammonite said to them, I will make with you on this condition, that I will gouge out the right eye of every one of you. Thus I will make it a reproach on all of Israel." So you want a deal? A I'm going to poke out everybody's right eye, all the men's right eye. Want to make a deal? That's what I wanted. See, what he wanted to do was, what that does is, they brought out the right eye. When I understood, I don't know how they did it up there, but they held their shield with the right hand, and so, with the left hand, was right hand? Right hand. And so they had, or the left hand, that's right. They held the shield with the left hand, so the left eye would be blocked, so they would see everything with the right eye. So if they blinded the right eye, they wouldn't see nothing with the shield. So they couldn't fight. See, I got it right. Left hand shield. They hold the right hand. Unless you're left-handed. Then maybe you go, yeah. You know, you're right-handed, you get to fight. Left-handed. So, he was going to take care of them. Does that sound like a fair deal to you? Mark, would you do that? Hey, I'll let you poke out my right eye. I hope I can deal with you. What? Sounds like an awful deal to me, Yeah, but listen. Verse 3. The elders of Jabesh said to him, let us alone for 7 days that we may send messengers throughout the territory of Israel, that if there's no one to deliver us, we will come back out to you. It's kind of like you're saying, give us 7 days to find some people to help us fight you. And if we can't find anybody to help us fight you, then we'll come back and make the deal with you. Well, 7 days. I would say, no way. 7 days to get your army together? Even if you're going to come fight, fight not just wipe them out, don't give a chance to get people to help them, right? That doesn't sound right. That's not what I would do. But you know what? I believe that Nahash was pretty confident that they were not going to find people to fight. So he's going to ask them to go. And you say, why is that, Mr. Jim? Because when you look at Israel's past, and he probably knew that, I'm not going to read it, but I'll just kind of rehash the story with you in Judges 19, 1922 to Judges 20. There was a story of a man who had a concubine. He was visiting this area, and he went to a man's house to stay in the man's house, and the man had a daughter, and the people of the village, they wanted to take the man out and have a relationship with him. They wanted to rape him. And said, no way is that going to happen. Take my daughter and his concubine, my virgin daughter, and his concubine, but don't touch the man, because that's not right. And those guys, they were worthless, perverted guys, obviously, to want to do something like that. Well, they took the concubine, and they raped her, and they molested her, and they beat her, and they abused her all night long. And then the morning when the man, it was his concubine, came to the door, she died. She was abused. So the man was pretty upset. So he took her and he cut her into 12 pieces. I wouldn't do that to you, babe. I promise. Cut her into 12 pieces and sent her to the tribes of Israel to get the people to rally together. And so when the people of Israel saw that, they came in and wiped the people out of the Benjamin. It was the tribe of Benjamin that this guy was from. These bad guys were from the tribe of Benjamin. So the people of their people protected them. Instead of saying, hey, take these worthless slugs, they decided to defend them, so they wiped them out. Well, everybody came to help but one village, Jabesh Gilead. They did not come. And Nahash knew this. These guys didn't come and help. So why would anybody come and help them? Probably his thinking. There's nobody's going to help them. They didn't. We know the story. They were, they kind of went in and the story goes on and they had went into Jabesh Gilead also and gave them a hard time too. So nobody's going to come and help them. He's thinking in his mind, probably. So, in verse 4, it says, then the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul and spoke these words in the hearing of the people, and all the people lifted up their voices and wept. So, you know, Nahash said, yeah, go ahead. See if you can get some people to help you. And they bring the message, and the people started weeping. They felt bad. And then, behold, Saul was coming from the field behind the oxen. And he said, what is the matter with the people that they weep? So they related to him the words of the men of Jabesh. Then the Spirit of God came upon Saul mightily when he heard these words, and he became very angry. He took a yoke of oxen and cut them in pieces and sent them throughout the territory of Israel by the hand of the messenger, saying, whoever does not come out after Saul and after Samuel, so shall it be done to his oxen. And the dread of the people, the dread of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out as one man. Now, this is interesting. See, he's working in his fields. He's not, you know, in the throne room acting as king. He's working in the fields. He hears this. He gets upset. He gets the Spirit of God falls upon him, and he gets angry. You say, wait a minute. The Spirit of God falls upon someone, and then they get angry? Righteous anger. Remember, there is a righteous anger. There is an anger that is okay. Jesus had it. Remember, when he went in the temple and turned it upside down in the temple. He had a righteous anger. It's not the kind of anger we get when we meet somebody with a bone. Or yelling at each other. It's a different kind of anger. It's the kind of anger when something happens, you're really upset that somebody would do that to that person, you know? Hurt a child. The things we see in the news today going on in the world, just, get that righteous anger in your heart. You know, in Ephesians 4, 26 and 27, it says, be angry and do not sin. What do you mean, Christian? Be angry and do not sin. Well, do not let the sun go down on your wrath or give place to the devil. Do not let the sun set on your anger. In other words, you can have this anger in you, but you deal with it before the sun goes down and get rid of it. Otherwise, if you keep it, when you wake up in the morning, you've planted a seed of bitterness in your heart that will grow and become bitterness and not on righteous anger any longer. So you deal with it. Yeah. If you don't let the sun go down to your wrath. Very important for those who are married and your families, that when you're mad at each other, you deal with it and it's over with before the sun goes down. You don't want to go to bed have that anger. It's not good. You just need to deal with it. I mean, how many times do you hear this story about people getting mad at each other and then something happens to the one person? I mean, was the last thing you want to have said to that one you love? Why you balloon? Hang a bottle? You know? You deal with it quickly. Sometimes love has to be tough love. You deal with it quickly. So, and then what's he do? He cuts up an oxen. Remember how the guy cut up the people? I mean, everybody knows the story, you know, about Jabesh Gilead. He cuts up the oxen. And whoever doesn't come out, so this is going to happen to their oxen. In other words, nobody's sitting back on this one. They're all coming. In verse 8, he numbered them in Bezek, and the sons of Israel were 300,000, and the men of Judah 30,000. They said to the messengers who had come, thus you shall say to the men of Jabesh-Gilead, tomorrow by this time the sun is hot, you will have deliverance. So the messengers went and told the men of Jabesh, and they were glad. Then the men of Jabesh said, tomorrow we will come out to you. He says this to Nahash, okay? Then the men of Jabesh said, tomorrow we come out to you, and you may do whatever seems good to you. And the next morning Saul put all the people in three companies, and they came into the midst of the camp at the morning watch, and they struck down the Ammonites until the heat of the day. Those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together, and they would wipe them out. They asked, tomorrow when the sun comes up, do whatever you want to us. That's why, you know what's going to happen. And Israel came in with Saul leading them and wiped them out. Didn't let two left standing. They won. And Saul wasn't even a soldier. He was a farmer. They led him into battle because he had the Lord with him. Remember that. Saul, King Saul, at one time, had the Lord with him. He was anointed king. Wow. When the Spirit comes upon you, guess what? You can do anything. You can do do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens you. When the Spirit comes upon you, you can do it. Lord, fill me with your Spirit right now so I can speak your words. I mean, you know, whatever it might be. Ask the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. You can do anything. Then 12 and 13, verse 12 and 13. Then the people said to Samuel, who is he that said, shall Saul run reign over us? Bring the men up that we may put them to death. You know, because Saul led him to victory. Now people say, hey, we're those worthless guys. It's fair. Saul's not going to reign over me. He's not going to be king. Where are those guys? Let's kill them. But Saul said, not a man shall be put to death this day, for today the Lord has accomplished deliverance in Israel. Hey, let's not ruin this good day. Look what the Lord has done. Why go ruin it by killing our own? For you and I, God has forgiven you and I. That's a good day. So why don't we forgive each other? We give it off to the Lord. God has forgiven me. God has loved me. I should love others. God has delivered them. Hey, why should we go kill somebody else? Don't ruin the day. Sometimes we do that. We can be filled with the Spirit. We can be doing things for the Lord. And the next thing you know, we're coming down on somebody, angry with somebody, upset with somebody about something dumb. We need not to do that. We need to have forgiveness. God has been good to us. We need to be good to others. Not be mean to other people. And then the last two verses in 1 Samuel 11, then Samuel said to the people, come and let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom there. So all the people went to Gilgal, and there they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. There they also offered sacrifices of peace offerings before the Lord. There Saul and all the men of Israel rejoiced greatly. He had coronation there, Gilgal. They made him king. Now he is their official king. He led them into victory. They saw that God's hand was upon Saul. So they made him king. And then we're now in chapter 12. Then Samuel said to all Israel, behold, I have listened to your voice and all that you said to me, and I have appointed a king over you. Now here is the king walking before you, but I am old and gray, and behold, my sons are with you, and I have walked before you from my youth, even to this day. You know what? Samuel's walk was consistent, and it started when he was a child. He lived in with Eli. He lived in the temple. Samuel was a godly man from his youth. You know, that tells me that our children can walk with the Lord all of their days. They don't have to have teenage years of rebellion. So, oh, they're just teenage rebellion. That does not have to be that way. They can walk with God all the days. We know teenagers. We know young people that have done that. Your kids can do that. Samuel did it. And he's telling them, hey, I've walked uprightly my whole life. Our kids don't have to go through the junk of life. They don't have to experience the things we experience. They can actually even listen to us and not go through those things that we went through. So there's hope there for us. They don't have to stray. Then in verse 3, he says, here I am. Bear witness against me before the Lord and his anointed. Whose oxen I have taken, or whose donkey have I taken, or who have I defrauded? Whom have I oppressed? Or from whose hand have I taken a bribe to blind my eyes with it? I will restore to you. Hey, if I've done anything wrong, let me know and I'll make it right now. Did anybody find anything in my life, as he said, anything in my life that is not right? Bring it up right now. I'll make it right. They said, you have not defrauded us or oppressed us or taken anything from any man's hand. He said to them, the Lord is witness against you, and his anointed is witness this day, because you have found nothing in my hand. And they said, he is witness. Then Samuel said to the people, it is the Lord who appointed Moses and Aaron, and who brought your fathers up from the land of Egypt. So now take your stand, that I may plead with you before the Lord concerning all the righteous acts of the Lord, which he did for you and your fathers. Samuel's telling them, hey, you know what? We haven't done anything wrong. God, he's showing them that God has not done anything wrong. He's going to look at that in a few minutes. I've done nothing wrong. So take your stand, because I'm going to plead your case before the Lord now. Because, you know, they've rejected God as their king. And along that, they really rejected Samuel by not taking his advice, by saying God is king. So he's letting them know that. And in verse 8 it says, when Jacob went into Egypt, and your fathers cried out to the Lord, then the Lord sent Moses and Aaron, who brought your fathers out of Egypt and settled them in this place. But they forgot the Lord their God, so he sold them into the hand of Sisera, captain of the army of Hazor, and into the hands of the Philistines, and into the hand of the king of Moab, and they fought against them. They cried out to the Lord and said, we have sinned because we have forsaken the Lord and have served the Baals and the Asherah, but now deliver us from the hands of our enemies, and we will serve you. And the Lord sent Zerubbabel, and Bedan, and Jephthah, and Samuel, and delivered you from the hands of your enemies all around, so that you live securely. Reminding them of their history. Listen, here's what God has done for you. And he's delivered you from your enemies when you cried out to him. He's reminding them of that. It's so easy for us to forget what God has done in our life and be focused on the circumstances and the things that we're dealing with in life right now. Or whenever. If we just seem to sometimes forget the Lord. Then, in verse 12, when you saw that Nahash, the king of the sons of Ammon, had come against you, you said to me, no, but a king shall reign over us, although the Lord God was your king. See, that's interesting there. That tells me that this was happening, and they were crying, and Nahash was threatening them. He was coming against them, and they said, we want God to lead us to the battle. We want to find a man to lead us to the battle. So that was before they had a king. Nahash was doing this before that, okay? That's what this is saying. Now, therefore, in verse 13, here is the king whom you have chosen, whom you have asked for, and behold, the Lord has set a king over you. If you will fear the Lord and serve him and listen to his voice and not rebel against the command of the Lord, then both you and also the king who reigns over you will follow the Lord your God. You know what? This is grace. You've blown it. You've rejected God. But he's pouring out his grace on you right now. He will still take care of you. He will still love you. But you need to follow him. You need to follow his ways. He will still bless you. You know, isn't that the nature of our God? Isn't that the nature of Jesus? We go out, blow up, we stumble, we fall, and he still loves us. He still blesses us. What a great God you have. Then, verse 15. There's no but there, but I'm going to say, but if you will not listen to the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the command of the Lord, then the hand of the Lord will be against you as it was against your fathers. Even now, take your stand and see this great thing which the Lord will do before your eyes. Is it not the wheat harvest today? I will call to the Lord that he may send thunder and rain. Then you will know and see that your wickedness is great, which you have done in the sight of the Lord, by asking for yourself a king. So Samuel called to the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day, and all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel. Isn't Samuel great? I mean, God, bring the thunder and rain. You know, we have the same faith. We have the same God. He had that kind of faith. He's going to show the people, listen, you need to repent. God's going to forgive you, but you have to realize the big mistake that you've made by rejecting God as your king. And just to show you that, I'm going to call on God to bring thunder and rain. You're going to repent. And they did. And the people, well, they feared the Lord, and they feared Samuel. You know, I'll never forget, and I've told you guys a story a few times, I'm sure, when we were in the Philippines on a missionary outreach, and we were in front of this traditional Catholic church, the Philippine Catholic Church is different than the Catholic Church here. They have idols everywhere. They worship idols everywhere. I mean, it's out, just out of your face, worshiping of idols in the Catholic Church in the Philippines. And they, in front of this Catholic Church in the Philippines, was a tree. It was this huge tree, and they worshiped it. It was an idol to them, this tree. And we were doing a concert in front of the tree. Now, I felt sometimes, you know, not a lot of times, but sometimes I feel the presence and the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon me, just like maybe like Saul did there, you know what I mean? Whoa! You know, and I'm speaking, and everything I'm speaking is like, wow, God's speaking to me. It's like I wasn't even talking. And I realized at that moment, and what I was talking about, I was telling the story about, choose who you're going to serve today. These idols, these things, you know, and I was giving the message about Elijah, the fire coming down from heaven, you know, consuming the offering, you know, the message I got there, that one. And I was talking about it, and just all over me, at one moment, a flash in my brain, and it was like I could have said, and Lord Jesus, fire consume this tree, and it would be gone. I knew it. And I remember just thinking that, and then I said, that's scary. My flesh got right in the way. And I was like, whoa, you know, I mean, wow. And then I continued on the message. But it was a really, I know that if I would have asked for it, it would have done it. That's how powerful the anointing that, you know, that was on me. You know, I'm not one of those guys, the anointing's always on me, I'm blowing over, and, you know, all that stuff. Not me, but occasionally things like that do happen. And then I'll never forget it. The other night, our sister Eileen, you know, Eileen came here years ago and taught the women's retreat. She was there, and I shared that with her, and she's going, whoa. You know, I said, if I would have done that, that power would come down and take that tree, what do you think we'd have done? She said, fall on our faces and repented. And I go, yeah, wham! That's what I thought too. I mean, if I would have done that, what would you do if God gave you that thing to do? In the name of Jesus, fire come down, whoosh, right in front of the people, bam, the tree's gone. At least that's what I thought. And probably, you know, God would strengthen me and I would continue on with it. Now you guys know I'm all crazy. So, Samuel, verse 19. The Lord had sent the rain, thunder and the rain. Then all the people said to Samuel, pray for your servants to the Lord your God, so that we may not die, for we have added to all our sins this evil by asking for ourselves a king. Samuel said to the people, do not fear. You have committed all this evil. Yet do not turn aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with your whole heart. My dad, when I'd share things with the Lord and share how much Jesus loved him and how God loved him and that God would forgive him for all his sins, and my dad would say, yeah, I can't be forgiven. I've done too much bad stuff. You know what? That's what Samuel's saying here. Continue following the Lord. God forgives you. He loves you. And the people that turn their back on God, he still accepted them. We turn our back on the Lord, he still accepts us. Such a loving God. Then it says, verse 21, you must not turn aside, for then you would go after futile things which cannot profit or deliver, because they are futile. But the Lord will not abandon his people on account of his great name, because the Lord has been pleased to make you a people for himself. Because God is a God of love, he's not going to turn on you. Because of his great name, because his name is love. Compassion, mercy, grace, because his name will not turn on you or us for his name's sake, because he is a loving God. And then Samuel says this about himself, moreover, as far as me, far be it from me that I should sin against the people by ceasing to pray for you, but I will instruct you in the good and right way. For Samuel's saying, if I quit praying for you, that is sin for me. I am not going to pray for you. You see, Samuel was a man of prayer. He knew the power of prayer. When he said, Lord, bring the thunder and the rain, boom, it came. Samuel knew it. You know, his name means ask for. Because remember, his mother had no children. Hannah, she was barren. She wanted a child, and she went and she sought after the Lord. She, you know, she prayed, and the Lord gave her Samuel. And she dedicated Samuel to serve the Lord all his days, and he did that. He had seen the power of prayer. He grew up in the house of prayer, in the temple. He was living in the temple. And he says, even though you do not listen to me, I will still pray. That's Samuel's heart. Even though you reject my advice, I will pray for you. You know that just for you, for you and I. Don't give up. For that person that doesn't listen to you. No, I don't want to go to church. No, I don't want Jesus. Don't give up. Samuel didn't give up. Don't give up. Keep praying. Keep praying. Keep asking the Lord for those people. Continue to do that. You know, you have to ask your question, am I a prayer? Do I pray for people? Will we intercede for people when they reject us? Don't forget that person. Those JWs that walk down the road, I'm not praying for them, but they're doing the rest of the village up. Lord, they need you just as bad as we do. Those JWs need to know Jesus, the real Jesus, not their only Jesus. They need to know the Jesus of the Bible so they can be forgiven for their sin. So we should pray for them. Abraham interceded for Sodom and Gomorrah, and it was a wicked city. And he prayed, remember the prayers, 50 alive, 40 alive, 30 alive, blah, blah, blah. And God brought the righteous out of the city. Abraham interceded for them. And he saved the righteous out of the city. Elijah, he had a full jar of wheat and a full jar of oil. It should make us think of how full we are with the Lord. And to pray for those who don't have as much as we have. Pray for those that don't have a filling of the Holy Spirit. Esther. Queen Esther, married to a king. For such a time as this, and went and prayed and interceded for her people that they would be saved. We have a king. No. Who, we haven't met the wedding day yet, but we're going to marry him one day. He's our king. We can go to him and intercede for people, just like Esther did. That people, God can save people. For those of us who are doing good in the Lord, pray for others. Pray. Pray for your church. Pray for your church leaders. Pray for your village, the leaders in your village. Pray. Intercede for people. And James says, you know, when we pray for the sick, healed. So we pray for the sick. Jesus said to the Father, I have prayed for those you have given me. Lord, I pray for those. Father, I pray for those you have given me. God has given you people in your life, family members, friends, co-workers. He's given to you. Be like Jesus. Pray for them. Those are the ones that he's given. Teach them the right way. Pass on the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let them see it in our lives. And then the last two verses in chapter 12. It says, only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider what great things he has done for you. But if you still do wickedly, both you and your king will be swept away. Israel, do right. Be truthful. But if you do wickedly, you're going to be swept away. You're going to be done. You're going to be gone. And then, you know, the Lord would say to you and I, do what's right. Fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider what great things he has done for you. And that's a word for you. That's a word for me. Right here in the Old Testament. Man, what great things he has done in our lives. In his word, and the great things he's going to do, and the place he's preparing for us. Serve him. But don't do, you know, you don't want to do wickedly, because we will be swept away. it'll hurt us. It'll put that wedge between us and the Lord. That's what we want. That's right. So a good word here for us in Samuel 11 and 12. Once again, God's word is so good. Let's pray. Father, what a godly man Samuel was and is. He's with you right now. And again, the examples that you give us in the Word of how to live, Lord, and how to act. And the encouragement that you give us, Lord, that man, even when we fail and we turn against you and we do rotten stuff, Lord, you still love us. You still forgive us. And you're still there for us. And we see how you are with the children of Israel. And you're our God also. And you love us the same. We thank you so much for that, Lord. It's so encouraging to know that we have another chance, no matter what we've done. You're still there for us. You will never leave us nor forsake us. And Father, we pray that you give us a heart to intercede for our families, and friends, co-workers, village, neighbors, wherever we're at, Lord, give us that heart of prayer, like Samuel had. Oh, Samuel, Lord, he says, oh, if I don't pray for you, that sin, I have to pray for you. Lord, give us that kind of a heart. Thank you, Lord, that you can do that, that you will do that, because we can do all things in Christ Jesus, who strengthens us, Lord. You can give us that in our lives. Give us a life of prayer. So go before us now, Lord. Use us this week. Father, we pray for those that are not with us tonight, Lord, that you would bless them, whatever they're doing. Father, be with them. I pray, Lord, that they're walking with you, they're serving you, whatever they're doing right now.